We have the It Cast happening tonight, where we have really courageous conversations around sex. And the one and only Nika Sherelle brings that conversation to the Veggie Lounge. And they have two amazing guests. I'll let Nika take it from here. But thank you so much.
Thank you. Thank you. Glad to be back as usual. Love this community. So I want to say thank you for joining us. My name is Nika Sherelle, and this is Black Health Story Month. We're going to go over the history of Black sexual health in America. Our guests tonight include Mayia Ogbebor, the manager of community health programs at the San Francisco AIDS Foundation. And we also have Quandra Chaffers. She's the owner of Sexual Abuse and Sex Solutions Therapy. So please take a second to introduce yourselves to our community and say a few words about who you are.
Absolutely. Thanks for having us. So I'm Quandra, and I am a clinical social worker. I have my practice on the cusp of the Castro on Market Street and Church. I've been doing private practice now for 3 years, but I've been in the game about 9 or 10, depending on how you want to count, post-grad school.
Come on.
I was told that we want to identify sexually, so she, her, hers. I consider myself kinky by identity, polyamorous by trade right now, and what else did we want to know?
So how you identify age, race, gender, sexuality, location of origin, where you currently live, anything of that you want to share?
For sure. So I was born and raised here in the Bay. I'm 33. I identify as African American and Black, and cisgender. I have a lot of privilege, I think, within gender. And I identify with the diaspora in general. Mm-hmm. So we're all one and connected that way.
I'm Mayia Ogbebor. I am the community health, a manager of community health programs at the San Francisco AIDS Foundation. As far as how I identify myself, that's an interesting question, because I just identify myself as Mayia. Mm-hmm. Pronouns, she, hers, but doesn't really matter. I just am who I am. As far as my race is concerned, I view myself very interestingly, because I come from two very different Black backgrounds. So I have my African-American background, which is very important to me. Got the blood of slaves running through my veins. And then I also am Nigerian. So I also have that part of me as well. So I identify on two levels of Blackness. Mm-hmm. Anything else?
I just want to pause to just acknowledge that you both work in San Francisco, mm-hmm. and that people get to see you and experience you. You know, we live in San Francisco, And every time we see a black person, it's like a sighting. And so it just feels really good. When you said the cashier, I knew exactly where you were. Mm-hmm. And then when you said that, I was like, wow, you know, do you both know each other prior to this? You work so close, work so close to proximity. But I don't know. I feel proud to know that we have strong queens, or however you like to be acknowledged, right here in San Francisco. It's really important.
Yeah, we're holding on. I know everybody wants to run over to Oakland. Yeah. That's where the pumpkins are now. But we do have a community here. A lot of my friends moved on and moved away. But
yeah.
I know that I also have a strong following of other therapists of color and many mm-hmm. black clinicians that I would shout out if need be, because my practice is full. But I know where to send you if you also want black people to get healing.
Yeah.
To do your healing with in San Francisco proper.
Mm-hmm. You have no idea what you're saying to us.
Yeah, it's important.
Yeah, we will be reaching out to you.
100%. I love that. And we were definitely going to discuss some resources today. Before we dive into that, I just want to talk about the current state of sexual health in the black community right now. Like, as we understand it, there are some things that are missing. There are some things that are prevalent. And I know that we all have very strong opinions about, like, what's going on right now for our people. So let's dive in. Let's, like, get this discussion going. And would you like to share the trigger warning for the community who might be listening, people out there going through stuff?
Yeah, thanks for reminding me, Nika. Absolutely. So I deal in trauma. Most of my practice is helping people overcome the stories of what's wrong with me and change that into that is a thing that happened to me. Mm-hmm. And so I know we're going to get into the shame and stigma pieces. But in general, before you've done your trauma work, we all have these natural coping skills in us to basically check out. In therapist lingo, we call this dissociation, and we all do this in small doses. But if you really want to be present and not feel like this talk is too much, then I like to give people a really simple tool to come back to earth. I call it the 5-4-3-2-1 rule, and you're basically working through your five senses. It doesn't matter which one you start with, in case you forget which one I did. But wherever you are right now, take a moment to land, take a deep breath, let out slow, look around the room, spot five things you can see that are black, name them in your head, take another deep breath, let out slow, take a moment to kind of hear what's going on, four things you can hear. If there's nothing on the street, outside of you, next to you, you can tap on a table. Notice if it sounds different than if you lightly brush the tip of your fingertips. Take another deep breath. Let it out slow. Take a moment to touch something. Something not your cell phone, which brings us out of the moment. And does it feel different? Does it feel warm at the palm of your hand versus your fingertips? Name one other thing about the texture. That would be three things we touched. And then the second would be smell. It's usually easier to find something we can smell than something we can taste, which is why I like to put it at second. So that could be something on your person, like shampooing your hair or laundry on your clothes. It can actually be something like incense, something that brings you calm, brings you peace. Something that reminds you of home, like cooking, or hopefully something safe. And then we close with taste, which, fun fact, are when we are nervous, we go into fight and flight. And so your body doesn't want to spend a lot of energy doing digestive work or these extra things that aren't going to keep you safe from the tiger. It wants you to run, fight it off, or shut down in some way. So if you are unsure about whether or not you are checked out, you might want to bring your attention to, can I make saliva? That is, we do that in a relaxed state in the parasympathetic nervous system. So switching to something like imagining a lemon or taking a swig of water, something that you actually can taste is great. but you can always imagine, and your body doesn't know the difference between real and imagined pain or pleasure.
Thank you for that.
Thank you.
Put a pin in that one. Your body doesn't know the difference.
Right. Okay. Salivary glands right now.
I know. I'm like.
So, Mayia, can you talk to us a little bit about what's going on with you and the conversation around PrEP?
So one of the things that I'm noticing is that PrEP awareness is not being spread evenly throughout the Black community. That's one of the things that I'm most concerned about. There is PrEP that is being integrated in other communities except the Black community, and especially for Black women. So a lot of times Black women don't even know that PrEP is for them or for us. And when I talk to Black women about PrEP, their thing is, well, I see billboards, I see PrEP being advertised, but the images that I see, mm-hmm. they don't look like me. Mm-hmm. I see two men, or I see a Caucasian person or mm-hmm. couple. Mm-hmm. I don't see a Black woman, mm-hmm. or I see a trans person. And so my thing is, we need to get to a point where we're telling our people that PrEP is for you. Even men who choose to sleep with men. Where, and I was sharing this with Nika and Quandra just a little while ago, is that one thing that I know is these are conversations within that community. However, Black men are still one of the, Black men are still not on PrEP like their white counterparts. And the question I have in my mind is why?
Well, I have a bigger question. Yeah. What is PrEP? And why are people worried about it? But, well, I can tell you from a perspective of someone just sitting on the couch looking at TV. Yeah. It looks like one of those commercials with a laundry list of issues.
Yeah.
So visually, it looks like something that people don't want to be bothered with. But tell us what the benefits are and why in particular we're looking for Black people to take it.
So PrEP is a pill. And anytime you take a pill, there may be side effects that are involved. So PrEP is a pill that you take every day. And what it does is it significantly reduces the ability to come into contact with HIV. That's what it is. It's a great preventative drug. So it's Truvada. And Truvada is very sketchy right now. There's a lot of things that's going on with Truvada as far as what it does to internal organs. But they're also playing with other medications like Descovy and things like that are a little bit gentler on the internal organs. But that's what it's for. It's a great way to prevent the spread of HIV from person to person. Mm-hmm. And so, like I said, it's something that you take every day. And if you did not want to take a pill every day, they have something called PEP. And PEP is when you come into sexual contact with someone, say it was just random, you go take the pill. So it's best to take it within 24 hours. You can take it up to 72 hours, and you'll still have that protection in your body from coming in contact with the virus.
Wow. Yeah. That's different for it to be on the back end. You know, kind of, wow. Yeah.
So what I'm thank you.
Yes.
What I'm hearing is that PrEP is a preventative antiviral.
Yes.
Now, is this something that you would take if you already have contracted HIV? Is this something that you would take to prevent yourself from contracting it, spreading it? Like, when is appropriate and who should be on this?
So anybody who's sexually active, it's beneficial to be on PrEP. You have to be negative because it is to prevent HIV from coming into contact with the body. So if you're already HIV positive, it's not going to help. But you are still on those medications anyway, because PrEP is an HIV med. I mean, that's what Truvada is, that's what Descovy is. People who are HIV positive take some sort of drug like that anyway. So, yes, it is specifically for people who are negative, and you need a prescription for it. It's fairly reasonably cost with some insurances, especially here in California. In other places, not so